I want to relate to you a conversation that our next speaker, Jerry and Buddy, had. Now, Jerry and Buddy don't remember this conversation, so I'm enlightening them at the same time. But Buddy said, "Jerry, you've been preaching a long, long time. Can you tell me who are the three greatest preachers that you know?" And Jerry said, And Buddy said, "You can't think of them, can you?" He said, No, I can't think of the other two. So the greatest preacher of all time is going to speak to us on the attempts to justify church members who fellowship those and theirs. Jerry, come speak to us.
He's right. I don't remember that conversation. You remember it? I don't either. I think there's something wrong with Ken.
Our not remembering doesn't mean it.
No. We've all heard it, haven't we? Well, I just love Brother So-and-so. I couldn't disfellowship him. We've been friends too long. I've known his family. People have a lot of excuses in their attempts to justify error and those who fellowship error. If you look at 1 John chapter 1, 1 John chapter 1, verses 6 and 7, John wrote, "He that saith he abideth in him ought himself also to walk even as he walked. Brethren, I write no new commandment unto you, but an old commandment that ye had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word which ye have heard from the beginning." If we abide in Christ, we ought to walk as Christ walked. We ought to do what Christ did in obedience to God. And he walked in obedience to his Father always. Though he were a son, yet learned he obedience by the things which he suffered. And being made perfect, he became the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him. Hebrews 5:8-9. Fellowship in Christ... For you and I to have fellowship in Christ is first dependent upon each of us being in fellowship with Christ. One is not in fellowship with Christ, or one who is not in fellowship with Christ, is not in fellowship with members of Christ's church. Now, that's a very simple statement, but it's the truth. That's what the Bible teaches. One who is not in fellowship with Christ is not in fellowship with members of Christ's church. Fellowship is defined as walking in the light as he is in the light. In 1 John chapter 1, verse 5, "Whoso keepeth his word in him, verily is the love of God perfected." 1 John chapter 1, verse 5. And yes, and in chapter 2. In chapter 2, I was looking at the wrong one, wasn't I? It's not Matthew, it's Mark. If we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanseth us from all sin. That's 2 John, by the way. The blood of Jesus Christ cleanseth us from all sin. Now, that is if, and there's the big if we walk in the light as he is in the light. If we say we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. Now, those who claim to be in fellowship with God, but who actually are in error, are liars. I didn't say that. The inspired John said that. If we say we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, then we lie and do not the truth. This is the message which we have heard of him, declaring to you, God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanseth us from all sin. So to walk in darkness is to teach and practice error. That's what that is. To teach and practice error. Over in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 14, the apostle writes there, be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness, and what communion hath light with darkness, and what fellowship or what concord hath Christ with Belial, or any part that he that believeth with an infidel? The lines are clearly drawn. We talk about withdrawing fellowship. In one sense, we do not withdraw fellowship. God does that. The lines are drawn, and God says, if you go past this, you are out of fellowship with me. And it is up to the church, it's up to Christians, you and me, to recognize that line that God has drawn, and when men go beyond it, to recognize that we're not in fellowship with them either, because they're no longer in fellowship with God. We don't determine fellowship. God determines that. But we can mark those who walk contrary to the doctrine which they have received. Those of us who grew up during the Cold War often heard the terms fellow travelers and useful idiots. Fellow travelers and useful idiots. And that was applied to people who, though they weren't members of the Communist Party, yet they were sympathetic to communist aims. Now, the term fellow traveler was used most often in the United States and Europe. That meant someone who wasn't a communist, but by his, if you, to put it in terms that maybe we can understand, by his fellowship with communists, he was a partaker of their evil deeds. He was a fellow traveler. Now, the Soviet communists loved those kinds of people. But they called them what they really were. The Soviets called them useful idiots. Very useful to the communist cause, but they were a bunch of idiots. And I think the world's still full of useful idiots today. Those people lent their influence, sometimes their money, to aid communist causes. They attended communist meetings. They spoke at communist gatherings and spoke at gatherings where communists spoke. Now, that's fellowshipping those communists. And they say, well, I'm not a communist, but I'll go speak there with him. Now, let that sink in. Those same people were useful to and were used by those Soviet communists. But even though Communist Party membership was outlawed in this country at that particular time, fellow travelers didn't have anything to fear from authorities here because their communist sympathies weren't illegal. Well, although communism's fellow travelers did nothing illegal, it is sinful to fellowship those who teach and practice religious error or attempt to justify them as those useful idiots did communists back during the Cold War. There are lots of excuses put forward today. Reasons for fellowshipping error. And I'm going to use a broad term here because a lot of things can fall under this term. And we may only speak of one or two things, but we're using a broad term. A lot of people excuse error and excuse those who fellowship and practice error because of sacred cows. You know what a sacred cow is. That comes from India, where they don't believe in killing cows. Their cows are sacred. They run loose over there. Sacred cows. Can't eat them, because that might be their grandmother or something. So you never know. Kill a cow in India, you may be killing some of your kin folks. So they're sacred. They don't touch them. Well, that's the way it is in the church today. There's some things you just don't touch. Some things you just don't touch. Formerly, sound men who never preached error now fellowship those who do. There are lots of formerly sound gospel preachers among us who would never have preached error, but the fellowship those who do. Prominent among those men were and are the administration, the faculty, the staff of the Memphis School of Preaching. Someone says, are you beating that dead horse again? Well, a little bit later we're going to show you that's not a dead horse. It's a horse, and it's a horse of a different color, but it's not dead. And we're going to keep beating it until somebody moves off center and repents. Memphis School of Preaching fellowships Dave Miller. And by failing, and they do that by failing to oppose his errors of reevaluation and reaffirmation of the eldership and his marriage intent doctrine. They don't oppose those. Now, they will tell you they do, but they'll go ahead and fellowship Dave Miller. Talk out of this side of the mouth or this side. I'm going to give you an example of their sidestepping, their... I guess you could call this the Tennessee two-step, or maybe the Kentucky two-step, since this took place in Kentucky. It's what I referenced yesterday, that same open forum at the Sunny Slope Church in Paducah, Kentucky, on July 15, 2006. This question, I'm going to read this question. I want you to listen carefully. This question was submitted during that open forum. Quote, in view of all that has been written over the last year in widely distributed Brotherhood publications, would Brothers Cates or Mosier please clarify whether the leadership of Memphis School of Preaching supports Dave Miller as director of Apologetics Press? Now, isn't that a simple question? Would you please clarify, make plain for us, whether you support the leadership of the school, supports Dave Miller as director of Apologetics Press? I want to read you what Curtis Cates said. Quote, first of all, let me say that we have never taught, as it is practiced among the liberals and so forth, elder reaffirmation and reconfirmation. Now, brethren, nobody ever said, accused them, or even Dave Miller, of practicing elder reevaluation or reaffirmation as the liberals do, putting a man in for 2 years and then voting him out. Nobody ever accused them of that. But that's what Curtis Cates said, that men have said. He said, we are opposed to it. To what? Well, he says elder reaffirmation and reconfirmation. Now, he had that little line in there that as it is practiced among the liberals, nobody ever accused him of that. He's sidestepping the issue, or he did sidestep it. Then he went ahead to say, last November, Brother Liddell spoke specifically against it in Missouri, and I amended it. Okay. That's fine. Whether you oppose it as the liberals practice it or whether you oppose it as it's practiced by Dave Miller, we're glad you oppose it. I was there. I spoke against it in Alabama back in October. Elder reaffirmation and reconfirmation. We have never taught that. We who? Memphis School of Preaching. And I don't suppose they ever did. Let me go back now. Let's go back. Refresh your memory on the question. Would Brother Cates or Brother Mosher please clarify whether the leadership of Memphis School of Preaching supports Dave Miller as director of Apologetics Press? What question is Curtis Cates answering in this reply? The question he's answering is, do you practice this error? Nobody asked him that. Nobody asked that. They asked, do you support Dave Miller as director of Apologetics Press? Then he goes ahead to say, we have never taught that. We have taught against it. Okay? Do you support Dave Miller as director of Apologetics Press? That's the question that was asked, not whether you taught against it or whether you don't support it or do support it. We shall teach against it as long as I have anything to do with the Memphis School of Preaching and the present faculty. Wonderful. Answer the question. But he never did. I'm going to ruin the story for you. I'm going to tell you, he never did answer the question. But now, here we go. He says, now, relative to Brother Dave Miller denies that they practiced what they're being accused of as having practiced. Okay? I'm sure. I'm sure that he does deny that. Do you support Dave Miller as head or director of Apologetics Press? That's the question. And Curtis Cates continued to answer. If you want to know more about that, I would encourage you to talk to Brother Dave Miller himself. He'll be glad to talk to you and clarify this. Clarify what? Whether you support him as director of Apologetics Press? That's the question. That's the question that wasn't answered. And, of course, later on, Keith Mosher gets into the act, and we talked about that yesterday, and he said that was a setup question. And these people that ask this question are vile, and I do mean vile, and later he said they're a bunch of liars. But he never answered the question. These people won't answer questions. Talk to Dave Miller himself. He'll be glad to talk to you and clarify this. Now, Apologetics Press, this is Curtis Cates speaking. I signed a letter for Apologetics Press to continue. I do not apologize for that. Well, Brother Cates was being honest there. We have several of our students who are connected, with apologetics prayers. Okay, here's the sacred cow. We can't do anything about apologetics prayers. We have several of our students from Memphis School of Preaching who are connected with them. And you know, that's pretty prestigious because we get a lot of money from Alabama to help support the Memphis School of Preaching and Apologetics Press, and we feed them our students, and that helps our students, it helps us, it helps them. Oh, man, no, we can't. It's a sacred cow. Can't kill that cow. That might be somebody's kin folks. And he said, I signed a letter. I don't apologize for it. We have several of our students who are connected with them and have been. And I have confidence in they're doing a great job in fighting atheism, Islam, you name it, denominationalism, and that type of thing. They're doing a great job. Apologetics Press. I don't think Apologetics Press ever produced error, did it? Nobody ever said they did. That wasn't the question, though. Do you support Dave Miller as director of Apologetics Press? Or are you just going to give him a pass because that's one of your sacred cows? To ask that is to answer it. Now listen to this part, what he said. Now, am I Brother Miller's press secretary? No. Oh, really? Sound quite a bit like it. You know, press secretary puts a pretty good spin on it. I heard him say that in Lubbock, Texas. I heard him say that standing in the living room of Tommy Hicks' house in Lubbock, Texas in 2005. I'm not Dave Miller's press secretary. Go ask him. That's called the spin zone. O'Reilly wouldn't let him in his no-spin zone, would he? He'd throw him out. But that is Kate's reply. Kate's reply to, would Brother Cates or Mosher please clarify whether Memphis School of Preaching, the leadership of Memphis School of Preaching, supports Dave Miller as director of Apologetics Press? And I read you what Curtis Cates said. Pertinent points, most of it. And he never answered the question. It's a sacred cow. Of course they support Dave Miller. Of course they support him being the head of Apologetics Press. Am I Brother Miller's secretary? No, but I would encourage you to talk to him, find out what he says. He's already said it. He's already said it. We'll see that in just a little bit. In the board meeting, and I think I got this information from Brother Hatcher, I'm not sure. But in the board meeting of the Gospel Journal on July the 20th, 2005, Brother McClish asked Brother Cates about his implicit endorsement of Dave Miller by his signing the AP Statement of Support with Miller as its director. Listen to this. Brother Cates said, we've got witnesses here of that too, that he did not endorse any of Miller's errors. He called them errors. He signed the statement of support for Miller and Apologetics Press, but he does not endorse Miller's errors. He knew they were errors. But he did support the continuation of AP. Now, that boils down to this. And I've asked this question a lot over the past 12 years, practically. If the Forest Hill elders went out and got Rubel Shelley to come over and be the director for the Memphis School of Preaching, would Curtis Cates sign a letter supporting the Memphis School of Preaching? No, he wouldn't. He is endorsing Dave Miller's errors. He's endorsing Dave Miller's errors. Well, that's the sacred cow excuse. Well, this is something, we got to keep this going. That's one of the so-called, I suppose, works, one of the nine works that Keith Mosher said that these people, I guess that's us, are trying to destroy. He would rather destroy the church than the works. So would Curtis Cates have done. I'm going by what he said. I know Curtis Cates has passed on. But I'm going by what he said. And it's on record. And I've got the audio of that open forum. Some people won't touch error. They'll fellowship it because of friends and family. Some people think more of their friends and their family than they do the Lord. That's been that way for thousands of years. It's always been that way. One preacher I know personally made the statement when all this fellowship issue came up in 2005 about Dave Miller. He said, well, I have friends on both sides of the issue. There's the answer. I have friends on both sides of the issue. We used to joke about George Nye, who probably was governor of Oklahoma longer than any other man. He was governor, lieutenant governor, back and forth. Finally, he went to UCO, University there in Edmond, as president. But George Nye was a consummate compromising politician. And the joke in Oklahoma was, if you asked George Nye about an issue, he'd say, well, some of my friends are for it and some of my friends are against it, and I'm for my friends. Well, that's the kind of answer this is. I have friends on both sides of the issue. Not even family ties should keep one from upholding the truth of God. Jesus said in Matthew 10, and that's not Mark either. In Matthew 10, beginning verse 34, think not that I am come to send peace on earth. I came not to send peace, but a sword. For I am come to set a man at variance against his father, the daughter against her mother, the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And a man's foes shall be they of his own household. He that loveth father and mother more than me is not worthy of me. He that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And he that taketh not his cross and followeth after me is not worthy of me. He that findeth his life shall lose it, but he that loseth his life for my sake shall find it. Jesus demands our undivided devotion and loyalty. He wants us to be loyal to him. We can't let family or friends or anyone stand in the way. He said, think not that I'm come to send peace on earth, and yet at his birth, the angel said, peace on earth, goodwill to men. Was there a contradiction? No. Paul wrote in Romans 5:1, therefore being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. The peace the angels were talking about was peace between God and man through Christ. The peace that Jesus is talking about when he said, I didn't come to send peace on earth, but a sword, he's talking about the division that would be brought about in families by the gospel of Jesus Christ. It happened then. It still happens today. And people want to continue in fellowship with their families because, well, my family is for it. Well, some apologists say, oh, if you oppose that, you're being divisive. Right, David? That's being divisive. Well, if you go over in the Old Testament, if you look at 1 Kings. We'll look at 1 Kings, the 18th chapter. Verse 17. Elijah has been estranged from Ahab because of differences. And Ahab hates Elijah because Elijah speaks God's word. And in the 17th verse of 1 Kings 18, Elijah met Ahab, and it says, "It came to pass when Ahab saw Elijah that Ahab said unto him, Art thou he that troubleth Israel? And Elijah said, he answered and said, I have not troubled Israel, but thou and thy father's house, and that ye have forsaken the commandments of the Lord, and thou hast followed Balaam." People being divisive who are marking false teachers are not being divisive. The false teacher is divisive. Back in the late 19th century, David Lipscomb was accused of dividing the church in Tennessee. You know what he, quote, divided it over? Instrumental music. How's that? He objected to it on scriptural grounds, and he was right. These people wanted to bring the instrument into the worship. They wanted to add something to it, and he objected. So he divided the church? No. They divided the church. And so it is today. Their accusation is that those who oppose error are being divisive. But that's not so. Was Jesus divisive when he opposed the Pharisees in Matthew 23? Was Jesus being divisive when he said, "Ye hypocrites, whited sepulchres"? Was Jesus being divisive, calling them what they were? He called them a generation of vipers. Was that being divisive? No. Jesus was merely pointing out what they were. Was Paul divisive when he rebuked Peter's sin? Remember what he did over in Galatians chapter 1? Galatians chapter 2, verses 11 and 12. When Peter was come to Antioch, I withstood him to the face because he was to be blamed. Paul, you're being divisive. You shouldn't jump on poor old Peter. Paul said, I withstood him to the face because he was to be blamed. For before that certain came from James, he did eat with the Gentiles, but when they were come, he withdrew himself and separated himself, fearing them which were of the circumcision, and even carried away Barnabas and some others with him. And Paul said he was wrong, and I withstood him to the face, and Paul was not being divisive. Is it divisive to mark them which cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which ye have learned, and avoid them? That's what Paul said in Romans 16:17. It's not being divisive. Well, finally, there's one more thing I want us to look at. Have you heard this? And I imagine most of us may have heard something to this effect. Well, you know, he's not teaching that anymore. He's not doing that anymore. Oh, okay. Old brother so-and-so, he beat his wife and he got drunk. He quit the church. About a year later, he comes back and slides in on the back seat and sits there. And he's there for 2, 3, 4 weeks. And finally, he moves down a little. And they say, "Brother so-and-so, would you like to wait on the table?" Well, you know, brother so-and-so hadn't repented of what he did. Oh, well, he's not doing that anymore. He's not doing that anymore. That was months ago. Why can't we just be friends? Why can't we just let bygones be bygones? And I get so tired of hearing this. Let's get past this. Don't you get tired of hearing this? You know, I just wish we could just get past all this. In other words, don't deal with it. Put your head in the sand. Ceasing to sin does not remove past sin. The passage of time does not erase wrong. Look over in the book of Exodus. Exodus chapter 17, verses 14 through 16. This is when Amalek had attacked Israel. And Israel had fought against Amalek. And in Exodus 17:14, the Lord said unto Moses, write this for a memorial in a book and rehearse it in the ears of Joshua, for I will utterly put out the remembrance of Amalek from under heaven. You're going to do what, Lord? I'm going to wipe them out. And Moses built an altar and called the name of it Jehovah Nissi. For he said, because the Lord has sworn, the Lord will have war with Amalek from generation to generation. God said, write this down. I'm going to wipe out Amalek. Now, God did not have them to write it down so God could be reminded. God doesn't forget. He had them write it down for their own information. Write this down. I'm going to wipe out Amalek. Some 400 years later, over in the book of 1 Samuel, we read in verse 1 that Samuel said unto Saul, 1 Samuel 15:1, the Lord sent me to anoint thee over Israel, to be king over his people Israel. Now therefore hearken unto the voice of the Lord, the voice of the words of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, I remember that which Amalek did to Israel, how he laid wait for him in the way when he came up from Egypt. Now go and smite Amalek and utterly destroy all that they have and spare them not. But slay both man and woman and infant and suckling, ox and sheep, camel and ass. The passage of time neither mitigates nor negates sin. God doesn't forget. Man might, but God doesn't. In 1990, Dave Miller, Johnny Ramsey, and two instructors of the Brown Trail School of Preaching were designated by the elders to, in Miller's words, do the legwork in their action of reevaluation and reaffirmation of the elders. He further said that it was the elders themselves that initiated the process and implemented it from beginning to end, just as Saul told Samuel, well, the people wanted to do this. I did it, but yeah, the people wanted to do it. And though he did not initiate it, according to his statement, Miller said he aided them in it. Saul did the same thing. 1 Samuel 15:13-15. Saul said, I've obeyed the commandment of the Lord. Samuel said, then what means the bleeding of his sheep in my ears? And Saul said, well, they brought them from the Amalekites, for the people spared the best of the sheep and oxen to offer sacrifice. The people did that. Well, that wasn't what God told you. Then in 2005, Miller wrote his clarification of this whole matter, saying it is astounding that an event that occurred 15 years ago, an event that I have never neither repeated nor promoted since, should cause such a stir. Dave Miller's supposed to know the scriptures. It's amazing, he said. This happened 15 years ago and it's causing such a stir. Amalek could have said, whoa, wait a minute, Saul. That was 400 years ago. What are you doing here? We come to kill you. Why? God said so. Well, that's 400 years ago. Amalek could have said the same thing. We challenge anybody, any person, to point out the word repent or repentance in Miller's clarification, which he wrote entitled, For Honorable Brethren Who Sincerely Want to Know. The words repent or repentance are not in there. And he wrote and distributed that in 2005, and yet people are saying, well, he's repented. No, he hasn't. He didn't repent. If he had, he would have told somebody. Let me tell you, I've had to repent, and I've had to go before the church and make confession. And when I did, I said, I've sinned. Never seen that from the pen of Dave Miller. Well, these are just a few of the examples, specific examples, attempts to justify those who teach error and to justify their apologists. The principles that are contained in 2 John 9 through 11 apply to anybody who would fellowship error and attempt to justify them. My friends, there is one way to heaven. John 14:6, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. There's no other way to heaven. No such thing as a sinner's prayer in the Bible. No such thing as a mourner's bench or any of the other trappings of denominationalism to be saved. Jesus died and shed his blood for our sins, and it is his blood that cleanses us from our sins. But we contact that blood when we are baptized into Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, Acts 2:38, Romans 6:3 through 5. Jesus Christ died for your sins. I'm so glad he died for mine. I'm glad he died for yours, because listen, we would be helplessly lost today if he hadn't done that. He gave his own precious life for me because he loved me. Make it personal. Don't say for the world, say for me. And he did. And the old song says, I live for him who died for me. I hope if you are not a Christian that you will make the determination right now to live for Christ. To believe in the Lord Jesus, repent of your sins, confess your faith in him, and be baptized into Christ for the remission of your sins. Will you do that? Jesus pleads, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. That's the great invitation of our Lord. And we invite you to come, and hope you will, while together we stand and sing.